Macmillan Audio presents We Love Anderson Cooper by R.L. Maizes. Read for you by Barrie Kreinik. We Love Anderson Cooper. Marcus hadn't had sex with Gavin. Not yet. But he couldn't help thinking about it as he lay on his bed, listening through a single earbud to Rabbi Margolin's nasal recording of Leviticus chapter 20, verse 13. If a man lies with a man, both have committed an abomination. They shall be put to death. It was part of Marcus's bar mitzvah reading. In less than a month, he was supposed to chant those words from memory in a Cedarhurst Long Island temple. Marcus hadn't bothered with the second earbud because he didn't need to hear the recording in stereo to know he hated Leviticus. He didn't need to hear it at all. He swiped the file containing the Torah portion and deleted it. Just like that, the offending words were gone. He breathed easily, the air in his room suddenly light and abundant, his heart full and calm. On a poster above his dresser, Mets slugger David Wright leaned over home plate, gripping a bat. Marcus imagined hitting a home run and the crowd cheering. His mother, Miriam, was in her study. She wore a short-sleeved sweater tucked into pressed khaki pants and peered at documents open on two computer screens. She had been promoted to vice president at her consulting firm that spring. Less than 5 feet tall, she nevertheless frightened those who crossed her. Marcus stood in the doorway.
Mom?
Yes, she said, keeping her eyes on the documents. He would tell her everything if she turned around. Why should he keep his relationship with Gavin a secret? Hadn't she exclaimed, "It's about time," when the Supreme Court legalized gay marriage? Hadn't she worn a pride pin to the wedding of a lesbian cousin? After he told her, they would tell his dad, who would cry because he cried at everything, especially happy endings. His mom would open a bottle of champagne and say how proud they were of him for having the courage to be himself. Yes, she repeated. He couldn't say it to her back. She was busy. Marcus had overheard her say to his father the night before, "I don't know how I'll get it all done with Marcus's bar mitzvah and this project deadline coming up." She sat on the boards of three charities. "Do you need something?" she asked, still facing the screens.
"I accidentally deleted the rabbi's recording."
"How come you never accidentally delete Lil Wayne? I'll email you a backup." The next morning, he tried again to tell his mother.
"I can't read Leviticus."
His mother was late for work. He followed her through the house as she stuffed her laptop into a messenger bag and pulled on a navy jacket and heels that stabbed the carpet, leaving a bloodless trail.
"If you practice, you'll get it." "No, I can't say the stuff about gays."
He wanted her to ask why he couldn't say it. If she did, he would tell her. But if she didn't ask, his mother, who asked a million questions about everything, if she didn't ask, it was because she didn't want to know. "Don't take it literally," she said, staring at the entryway mirror as she applied plum lipstick.
"How else can I take it?"
"Tell yourself you don't mean it, or tell yourself you mean the opposite." She kissed the air in front of his forehead and hurried out the door, calling over her shoulder, "Don't forget your lunch." Furious, he trolled the temple's website that afternoon under an account he created for the purpose, Kosher Fag, leaving comments like, "God loves gays," and "Moses was queer." "God's watching," replied, "It's Adam and Eve, faggot," and "Sodomites burn in hell." The temple blocked both accounts.
"I don't want a bar mitzvah," Marcus announced at dinner. "Dad's not even Jewish."
"Your dad wants you to have a bar mitzvah," his mother said, though his father was sitting right there. "Don't you, Fritz?" Marcus's father cleared his throat. Sawdust clung to his unruly eyebrows. Marcus had heard him planing boards in his workshop before dinner. He towered over the kitchen table,
which he had built to suit his wife.
I want whatever you and Marcus want.
Over the years, the temple congregation had become more progressive, but the rabbi remained a zealot. Marcus couldn't remember his father ever attending services, though he occasionally picked up Marcus outside after Hebrew school.
Your father's welcome in temple if that's what you're worried about, his mother said.
With the bar mitzvah 2 weeks away, Marcus was miserable. Even thinking about the Mets-themed party his parents were throwing for him Saturday night after the service failed to cheer him up. He lay on Gavin's bed, his head on his boyfriend's stomach, his heart aching as if he had taken a punch to the chest, and decided once and for all he wouldn't read Leviticus. Gavin's parents were working late. The rapper Drake stared from a paisley hoodie in a poster pinned above the headboard. Jay-Z's Fuck With Me, You Know I Got It blasted from desktop speakers. Gavin was a popular boy whose habit of wearing untucked Oxford shirts, the last button undone, had been adopted throughout the seventh grade. Outside school, he wore headphones and crossed against lights, oblivious to honking horns and ambulance sirens. He was a foot taller than Marcus. For years, girls had been including Gavin in their trips to the mall and ice skating. Lately, he joined them at concerts, though Marcus complained of being left out. No girl ever asked Marcus anywhere, and boys never picked him to captain a team. Since Gavin kissed him behind the 7-Eleven 6 months ago, Gavin's lips cold and tasting like raspberry Slurpee, Marcus tried to tell himself he didn't care about his own lesser popularity. He'd been chosen by the only boy who mattered. Marcus had first suspected Gavin was gay when he saw him at their neighborhood community center, loitering outside the room where PFLAG was running a support group for queer kids. Neither boy had the courage to go in, but when they ran into each other at the 7-Eleven a few weeks later, Gavin had motioned for Marcus to follow him around back.
I'm not going to recite the Torah, Marcus said now.
The what?
Gavin was Catholic.
Leviticus, Marcus said. Fags are an abomination, I told you.
Gavin nodded, but Marcus didn't know if he was nodding to the music or because he was following what Marcus was saying.
Remember the valedictorian who came out in his graduation speech? His video was downloaded 2 million times, Marcus said. That's what I'm going to do in temple.
Gavin sat up abruptly, forcing Marcus's head off his stomach.
You're not going to mention me, are you? My father would kill me.
I won't mention you.
Don't even say you have a boyfriend.
Marcus wished they could come out together. Not only would they get to be themselves in public, but having Gavin as his boyfriend would be a social triumph. No one would ever exclude him again.
I won't. It'll be fine, I promise.
Gavin let out a breath.
You'll be famous. Everyone will be talking about you.
Marcus pictured kids at school congratulating him on his newfound celebrity. Gavin wound his fingers in Marcus's hair, tugging gently on the black curls. Marcus's scalp warmed. He felt pleasantly dizzy.
More guys our age should come out, Gavin said. I'd like to know who they are.
Marcus stared at the luminescent stars glowing dimly on the ceiling. He didn't like the idea of Gavin with other guys. Gavin pulled Marcus on top of him. Even fully clothed, Marcus felt as if they were one boy. They moved against each other, and Gavin found Marcus's mouth and wrapped Jay-Z's song into it. When Gavin tried to unbutton Marcus's shirt, Marcus brushed his hand away. It had been like that since the beginning, Marcus content to make out, Gavin pushing for more. Marcus knew he would eventually give in, but the idea scared him. He wasn't proud of his body the way he knew Gavin must be. He was short and doughy, and though Gavin had seen him in his bathing suit, it would be different if they were having sex. He hated the idea of disappointing Gavin. In his room later, Marcus had second thoughts about surprising his parents with an announcement in temple. His father fried schnitzel, Marcus's favorite, every Sunday night. The dusky smell of the sizzling meat almost made up for having to return to school on Monday. A math professor,
His father came from a long line of cabinet makers. He taught Marcus to build tables and desks using dovetail joints, handing him a fresh piece of wood without recrimination when Marcus missed a cut or cracked a pin, applying too much force in his impatience to join the boards. And his mother, she had written an absence note after he skipped school to attend the Met's opening day. She helped him with book reports, improving what he wrote with her own views on the basketball diaries and the house on Mango Street. Together, his parents attended all of his soccer and baseball games, though coaches often forgot him on the bench. But Marcus was afraid if he told them, his parents would try to stop him from coming out in Temple. His mother was secretary of the synagogue's Hadassah chapter, whose members took it upon themselves to enforce decorum in the sanctuary. If he told his father would tell Marcus's mother, so Marcus couldn't tell his father either. Marcus imagined taking a picture of himself in a rainbow Mets jersey in the photo booth at his party. He envisioned other boys finding the courage to come out at the party, and all of them dancing together. He kept his mouth shut. It was a warm May morning. In his bedroom, Marcus struggled to button his white dress shirt, his fingers sweating and wobbly. His father knotted Marcus's tie, while his mother ran a lint brush over his pristine navy suit jacket for a third time before handing it to him. When Marcus was dressed, his father wrapped an arm around his mother's waist, and they leaned into each other and observed him, a boy they thought they knew. His mother handed him a folded copy of the speech she had written for him and cleared with the rabbi and the youth director. The speech was about being a member of the Jewish community. Marcus didn't plan to read it. He had written something for himself that was about belonging to a different community. It was in the top drawer of his dresser, buried beneath a pile of tube socks. He had memorized it, but planned to bring it anyway, just in case. His father took out his phone to snap Marcus's picture. Marcus could tell how proud his parents were, how excited their only child would be honored in the temple, and he knew the day wouldn't go as they expected. Wiping his palms on his pants, he forced a smile. 2 hours later, standing on a stool behind the lectern, Marcus smelled bodies pressed too close together, Rabbi Margolin's musk aftershave, and the slow disintegration of parchment Torah scrolls lined up in the ark behind him. Soft light filtered through abstract stained glass windows just below the ceiling. The temple seats were covered with purple velvet and spring-loaded. When he attended services, Marcus half expected to find a bucket of popcorn between his knees. The rabbi rested a hand on Marcus's shoulder as he introduced him to the congregation, but Marcus wasn't listening. He was picturing a makeup artist preparing him for a morning show, just one of the many TV spots he imagined he would do after the video of his bar mitzvah speech went viral. The valedictorian who came out had appeared on the Today Show and CNN, and then there was Sam Horowitz from Dallas. The video of his bar mitzvah dance routine landed him on Ellen. After he was famous, Marcus thought he might do one of those It Gets Better videos that gave hope to gay kids. He looked down at his mother in the front row. She was smiling, displaying teeth whitened for the occasion. She held one of the dozens of small cellophane bags stuffed with candy she had distributed among the congregation to throw at Marcus at the conclusion of the service. Next to his mother sat his father, a silver skullcap perched on his head like a miniature alien craft. At his father's right was Marcus's grandmother, Helga, who had flown in from Hamburg. Knowing he was about to disturb a life cycle event, as the Hadassah ladies liked to refer to the bar mitzvah, Marcus's legs trembled. He clutched the lectern. He hoped his parents would understand that, confronted with Leviticus, he had to be honest about who he was. In the second row, Marcus's classmates from Hebrew school and Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School gazed down at silenced phones, texting or playing World of Warcraft, as he had done during so many interminable bar mitzvahs. Marcus located Gavin, whose cheeks were pink, whether from warmth or excitement, Marcus couldn't tell. A pale blue shirt fell easily across Gavin's chest. Mindful of his promise not to mention his boyfriend, Marcus looked away. The rabbi droned on, throwing out worn phrases Marcus heard at every bar mitzvah. Upstanding young man, future of the Jewish people, honor thy father and mother. The man seemed to have a boilerplate speech into which he plugged each boy's name. Perhaps after Marcus's announcement, the rabbi would talk about diversity, a subject Marcus couldn't remember him ever addressing. Marcus fingered the speech in his pocket his mother had written.
"Never be afraid to take initiative," his father had once said to him.
"That's what makes a leader," his mother added, only half listening as she bent over her laptop.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.